Up till now, we discussed the propagation of plane wave in an unbound medium. We oriented our coordinate system such that the wave propagated in direction of one of the axes, that was z axis. And we could do this because an unbound medium essentially is symmetric in all directions. So, no matter in what direction we looked, the medium appeared same. And that is the reason we had a flexibility in choosing the direction of the coordinate axis. However, if you have a medium which is a bound medium, then the medium does not appear same in all directions, and then the choice of coordinate axis might affect the analysis, essentially the algebraic manipulation which we will require in different ways. So, essentially now we choose the coordinate system so that the analysis of the problem becomes a little simpler. And when we do this, essentially the choice of coordinate axis gets restricted. So, first we will try to put a medium which is a semi-infinite medium. That means, we will divide the unbound medium into two halves, and then we will investigate the propagation of electromagnetic wave in this semi-infinite medium. And then slowly, as we proceed in this course, we will try to capture the electromagnetic wave in more and more bound media. However, before we do this analysis of the propagation of electromagnetic wave in a bound medium, we require a representation of electromagnetic wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction with respect to the coordinate axis. So, today we investigate the plane wave propagation in an arbitrary direction with respect to the coordinate system. If you recall, when we had a coordinate system such that the wave was propagating in the z direction, the phase variation for this electromagnetic wave was in the z direction, and the electric and magnetic fields lied in a plane which was perpendicular to z direction, that means they lied in the xy plane. We still have a medium which is unbound, but only thing is we are orienting the coordinate system in such a way that the wave is now moving in some arbitrary direction with respect to the coordinate axis. So, let us say if you have a coordinate axis, like this, and if this is the x direction, this is y direction. So, by right hand rule, when we put my fingers like this, I will get this direction as the z direction. Now, let us say the wave is propagating in some arbitrary direction which is moving in this direction. So, that is the direction of the wave propagation. So, let us say this is wave direction, and the constant phase planes, that means the plane in which the electric and magnetic field lies, they are now perpendicular to this direction. So, we have some planes which will be like that, which are perpendicular to this direction. So, these planes we call as the constant phase planes. So, where the wave propagates, essentially these are the phase front which are moving, and that essentially gives you the phenomena of wave propagation. Now, if you want to represent this wave, the wave is characterized by the wave function. That means, we have to now write down the wave function for this wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction. Let us say the directions which it makes with the x, y and z axis are given by the angles phi x, phi y and phi z. Then we can write down the direction cosines of this vector, this line, which will be cos of phi x, cos of phi y, cos of phi z. So, essentially we can write down the unit vector in the direction of the wave propagation. Let us denote that by n cap. That can be written as, so we have unit vector n that is equal to cos of phi x, x plus cos of phi y, y plus cos of phi z, z, where x, y and z are the unit vectors in the direction x, y and z, and these quantities cos phi x, cos phi y and cos phi z are what are called the direction cosines of this line. So, these quantities are the direction cosines. So, the wave motion which is in this direction, which is given by the unit vector n, is essentially characterized by the direction cosines, which are the cosines of the angles which this line makes with the three axes x, y and z. Let us say this vector intersects this wavefront at some point here. Let us say this point is O, let us say this point is A. Now, if I take some arbitrary point on this phase front, let us say which is this, let us say this point is P, I can write down the vector for OP if I know the coordinate of this point, and let us say the coordinate of this point are x, y and z. So, I can write down the vector OP which is x, x cap plus y, y cap plus z, z cap. So, I know this vector which is the unit vector in a direction of the wave motion. So, let us say we write this vector OP that is x, x cap plus y, y cap plus z, z cap. Now, if I look at this thing carefully, the normal distance, you take any point on this plane, which is the constant phase plane, the normal distance of this is given by OA. So, if I take any point on this plane and if I find out the projection of that direction in the direction of the normal, that quantity is OA and that is fixed irrespective of what point I take on the phase front. So, essentially the equation of this phase front is that the dot product of this vector and the unit vector that is equal to this which is constant. So, we have equation of the constant phase plane from here. And that is unit vector n dot product OP, that will be, this dot product will be always equal to this distance OA, where this point is the normal point on the wave phase front, then this is equal to mod of OA, which is equal to constant. If I substitute now for n cap and OP from here and here, I will get x cos phi x plus y cos phi y plus z cos phi z, that is equal to constant. And this constant is nothing but the magnitude of OA. That means it is telling me the distance of this plane from the origin. Now, if the wave is having a phase constant beta and if this distance OA, the phase of this plane is nothing but beta times the distance traveled, which is equal to OA. So, if I assume that the wave was having zero phase when it was passing through the origin, then the phase of this plane is distance OA multiplied by the phase constant, which is beta. So I have the face of the plane that is equal to beta into OA which is nothing but beta into n dot vector r, because this OP vector is the position vector of this point, which is nothing but denoted in vectorially, this is r vector. So I have a point P which is denoted by this position vector r, so this vector is r. Then the face of the plane is beta times the dot product of the unit vector in the direction of the wave propagation and the position vector of any point on that constant phase plane. Once you get the face of this plane, then writing the expression for the electric or magnetic field which is corresponding to this wave propagation is very straightforward. Essentially what we have now is some electric field vector which is lying in this plane, and the magnetic field vector is lying perpendicular to the electric field vector and the direction of wave propagation, and the phase variation for electric and magnetic field both is given by this phase one, this quantity, which is beta into n dot r. So what we can now do, we can write down the electric field for this wave, let us say E has some magnitude which is a vector quantity. So this E0 tells me the magnitude of the vector, and this vector nature tells me the direction which is lying in the plane of this constant phase front in this plane. And the phase variation of this is e to the power minus j beta into n dot r. And since electric field vector has to be perpendicular to direction of the wave propagation, we have the electric E0 dot n should be equal to 0, because E naught is perpendicular to so a transverse electromagnetic wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction given by the unit vector n cap can be represented essentially by this. What we can do is we can combine this beta with this n, and we can define another vector which is beta times this n cap, and we can call that vector as the wave vector. So essentially we define a parameter for this wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction as the wave vector, and let us denote that by small k, which is nothing but beta into n cap. Expanding for n cap, this is equal to beta into cos phi x, x plus cos phi y, y plus cos phi z, z. Taking beta inside, you get this wave vector k that is equal to beta cos phi x, x plus beta cos phi y, y plus beta cos phi z, z. Then this quantity essentially tells you the component of this wave vector in the x direction. This quantity tells me the component of the k vector in y direction, and this quantity tells me the component of the wave vector in the z direction. So we can denote these quantities as kx, ky and kz. So this quantity we can call as kx, this quantity we can call as ky, and this quantity we can call as kz. So this vector k is kx x plus ky y plus kz z. So if I know the direction of wave propagation, if I know the phase constant of the wave beta, which depends upon the medium parameters, then I can find out this quantity, wave vector, which completely characterizes the wave propagation in the arbitrary direction. And then as we wrote here that E dot E0 dot n should be equal to 0, the same thing we can write down for the k vector, that the direction of the electric field and the k vector are perpendicular to each other. That means the dot product of these two quantities should be equal to 0. We can now verify, when we had said the wave was traveling in the z direction, if I go to this, then my direction cosines, if the wave is traveling in z direction, the phi z is 0, phi y is 90 degrees, phi x is 90 degrees. So this is 0, this is 0, this is 1. So I get this k, which is equal to beta into z cap. And when I take dot product of that with this vector r, I get essentially beta into z. So the phase variation would be e to the power minus j beta into z, which is the same expression which we had got for the wave which was propagating in the z direction. So this is now a representation of the electric field for a uniform plane wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction, making angles phi x, phi y and phi z with respect to the three coordinate axes. The next step you will need is to finding out now the magnetic field corresponding to this electric field. And for this, we can again go back to the original Maxwell's equation. We are still dealing with the media which now do not have conductivity. So let us say we have a medium which is the source free medium, there are no currents, there is no finite conductivity, so the conductivity is 0. And then the Maxwell's equation is del cross E, that is equal to minus j omega mu into H. Since now E is known, it is given by this expression, I can substitute into this and I can find out the corresponding magnetic field. So I get from here the H is equal to minus 1 upon j omega mu into del cross E, which if I write in the determinant form, this will be minus 1 upon j omega mu determinant x, y, z, d by dx, d by dy, d by dz, ex, ey, ez. Now this electric field vector which we have got here, that also we can write down explicitly in its components. So essentially we have the electric field in general is equal to, if I expand this E0 in its components, this will be E0x, x plus E0y, y plus E0z, z, and the phase function which is e to the power minus j k dot r. So the Ex component is E0x e to the power minus jk dot r, Ey component is E0y multiplied by same phase function, the Z component is E0z multiplied by e to the power minus jk r. So I have three components for the electric field which I can substitute here. Now note here, this quantity E0x, E0y and E0z are not functions of the space. This electric field is constant. As we saw for uniform plane wave, the electric and magnetic fields, they vary only in the direction of the wave propagation. So they are constant everywhere in the space, and we have already taken out the variation of the phase variation which is in the direction of wave propagation out. So this vector essentially is a constant vector. So E0x, E0y and E0z are not functions of space, these are constant quantities. So only space variation which you have is only in this term, which is e to the power minus jkr. So let us say if I take any of the components and I take its derivative with respect to x. Derivative with respect to x will be derivation of this with respect to the x quantity. So we have d by dx of, let us say, any of these components, Ex component or Ey component or Ez component, that is equal to minus jkx, which we will get from here, multiplied by the same quantity which is either Ex or Ey or Ez. So what that means is that this operator d by dx is equivalent to multiplying the quantity pi minus j times kx. So this implies that this operator d by dx is equivalent to multiplying this quantity by minus jkx. Similar thing we can do for the other two derivatives also. So we have, by the same token, d by dy equal to minus j ky and d by dz equal to minus j kz. So this quantity is here in this determinant, d by dx can be replaced by minus jkx, d by dy can be replaced by minus jky and d by dz can be replaced by minus jkz. So you can substitute here, and from here we can get the magnetic field H that is equal to minus 1 upon j omega mu x y z minus j k x minus j k y minus j k z Ex, Ey, Ez. But this quantity is nothing but the cross product of this vector, which is minus j times k cross E. So we can write down this quantity as minus 1 upon j omega mu minus j k cross E. This minus j and minus j will cancel, so that is equal to 1 upon omega mu k cross E. We can immediately note here that k is the direction of the wave propagation, E is the direction of the electric field, and the magnetic field is the cross product of these two. That means the magnetic field lies perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation and also the direction of the electric field. That is what we have for a transverse electromagnetic wave, that the electric and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other and they are also perpendicular to the direction of the wave propagation. So from here, essentially we can calculate the vector magnetic field if the electric field is known. So what we have now, we started with some coordinate axis and we took the wave which is propagating in some arbitrary direction, which is making angles with respect to the coordinate axis, and then we found out the expression for the electric field in that arbitrary direction, which was this. Then substituting this electric field in one of the Maxwell's equations, essentially we got the expression for the magnetic field, and that expression is essentially this. So now one can find out the electric and magnetic fields for a transverse electromagnetic wave traveling in some arbitrary direction. Let us now try to see how this behavior of the wave in arbitrary direction with respect to coordinate axis affects our understanding of quantities like the velocity of the wave and so on and so on. So let us say I have a wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction, and for that the electric field is given as E0 e to the power minus j k dot r. If I expand this, this is E0 e to the power minus j, and k if I write down as beta times cos phi x, this will be beta cos phi x, x plus beta cos phi y, y plus beta cos phi z, z. Now let us look at only the phase variation, which is in z direction. So what I can do is I can just take this portion separately and the phase variation which is in z direction separately. So I can write this as E0, take this term separate, so e to the power minus j, let me take beta common here, so this is beta cos phi x, x plus cos phi y, y multiplied by the phase term which is minus j beta cos phi z, z. There are no unit vectors here. Two things should be noted from this expression, that this electric field, first of all, if I move now in the plane which is xy plane, then I have a phase variation in x and y direction. That means the xy plane is not a constant phase plane, and that is very obvious from this very first picture which you had taken, that constant phase plane is this plane now, which is inclined with respect to the axis. So if I take this xy plane, then this plane doesn't represent the constant phase plane. So the phase is not constant in this plane. So essentially you have a variation of the phase in the xy plane, which is varying like cos phi x and cos phi y. But you are having a variation in the z direction, which is given by beta times cos phi z. So if I now look at this wave and I ask a question, that once the coordinate axis was given and if the wave was traveling in some arbitrary direction, what is the velocity with which the phase point moves in the z direction, or what is the phase velocity of the wave in the z direction? So essentially what we do is we take the phase in the direction of z, which is beta times cos phi z minus beta times cos phi z. So the effective phase constant which this wave sees in the direction z is beta into cos z. So if I write down this, we have now the wave phase constant in z direction. That is, let us call that quantity as beta z, and that is equal to beta into cos of phi z. So, this wave for which the xy plane is not a constant phase plane, but if I ask what is the effective phase constant which the wave sees in the direction z, then we have the phase constant beta z, which is nothing but beta into cos of phi z. Same thing will happen in the other two directions also. So, the phase constant which we will have in the x direction beta x, that will be beta into cos phi x, and the phase constant which we will see in the y direction, that will be beta y, that will be beta into cos phi y. Once we have this, then we can go to our expression for phase velocity, and phase velocity is nothing but omega divided by the phase constant in the direction. So, omega by beta z gives me the phase velocity of the wave in the direction z. So, we get from here the phase velocity in z direction, and let us call that as Vp in z, which is nothing but omega divided by beta z, that is omega divided by beta into cos phi z. But omega by beta is the velocity of the wave in the direction of the wave motion. So, if I say that I do not have coordinate axis, in this direction the phase fronts are moving. If I ask what is the velocity of this phase front in this direction, that quantity is nothing but omega by beta. So, this essentially gives me the velocity of the wave in that unbound medium. Let us denote that quantity omega by beta as some v naught divided by cos of phi z. So, v naught is the velocity of the wave in the direction of the perpendicular to the constant phase front, that is the velocity of the wave in an unbound medium. But the phase velocity of the wave in the z direction is that velocity v 0 divided by cos of phi z. By the same token, we can have the phase velocities in the other direction, because your beta x is beta into cos phi x, beta y is equal to beta into cos phi y. So, this gives your phase velocities Vp in x direction, which is omega by beta x is equal to omega divided by beta cos phi x equal to v 0 upon cos phi x, and similarly we get Vp y, that is omega by beta y, which is omega upon beta cos phi y is equal to v 0 upon cos phi. So, the phase velocities of this wave in three coordinate axes are essentially given by the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium, which is v naught, divided by the direction cosines, which is cos phi x, cos phi y and cos phi z. Now, since the cos phi x, cos phi y and cos phi z are always less than 1, this quantity, the phase velocity, is always greater than the phase velocity, intrinsic phase velocity of the wave v 0. So, one important thing which we see from here, that these quantities v p x or v p y or v p z is always greater than or equal to when the direction cosines is equal to 1 is equal to the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium, which is V naught. Otherwise, this quantity is always greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave. Another important thing which we note here is that we can always have a wave which is traveling perpendicular to, let us say, x axis. So, the cos phi x will be 90 degrees and cos phi x will be 0. So, the phase velocity Vpx will be equal to infinity. That means we may have a situation in which the phase velocity may go to infinity. So, essentially the phase velocity always is greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium, and it can be as high as infinity. So, there is no bound on the phase velocity on the upper side, it can go as high as infinity. The lower bound on the phase velocity is the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. That is something interesting, because now we are talking about the velocities which are greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave. We know that the light is a transverse electromagnetic wave. So, the intrinsic velocity for the light will be nothing but the velocity of light in that medium. So, this quantity would be C. Then the phase velocity will be always greater than the velocity of that light in the medium, and it can go as high as infinity. We know from our basics of physics that the velocity for any physical system cannot be greater than the velocity of light. What is happening then here? We are having these parameters, what are the phase velocities, which are always greater than the velocity of light, and they can go even as high as infinity. Does that mean that we have found a mechanism of sending information now with speed as high as infinity? The answer is no. This velocity is not the velocity of any energy packet or a physical point in space. This is because the way we have defined the velocities, the phase velocities, which are based on the constant phase fronts, they essentially give you this condition that the phase velocities will be greater than the velocity of the wave, intrinsic velocity in that medium. Let us see this little carefully. So, let us say, to make the case simpler, let us say I have, this is x and z, and let us say wave is traveling in this plane, in this direction. So, let us say this is the direction of the wave, and these are the constant phase fronts which we have. Now, note, by the time this wave has traveled from this point to this point, the constant phase point, which is given by the entire phase front, this constant phase point moves from this point to this point. So, unless the wave is parallel to this, this distance which the phase point moves is always greater than the actual movement of this wave front. Why this is happening? In fact, this point has not moved to here. This point has actually moved from here to here. So, if I take some point A, the A point will move to A prime, whereas the point which has come here now along the z axis was originally what, not A point, it was this point B, and that point has come here, which is B prime. So, when the wave is moving, this point, if I just define a particular point on the wave front, this point is moving only by a distance which is A prime. However, when we are measuring the phase velocity, what we do, we simply measure the separation between the points on the z axis, which are separated by a phase, and I ask a question, how much time it has taken to change the phase from this value to this value. So, essentially we measure this distance, find out how much phase it has undergone, and then from there we essentially get the phase velocity. So the phase velocity is not actually giving you the velocity of a particular point on the phase front. In fact, when we define the phase velocity, the entire plane, constant phase plane, itself is behaving like a point. So we just here on this phase front we take this point, on this phase front we take this point, but both these points represent the same phase. So if you find the same phase point over here, we say that is the distance with the constant phase point has moved from this point to this point. And that is the reason we get the velocity which is greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave in the medium, because this is not representing the velocity of a particular point on the phase front. So this velocity, whatever phase velocity we get, this is not simply the resolution of the velocity vector in the three directions. Because if you had resolved the velocities in three directions, the component of the velocities would be always less than the actual vector. But in this case, we see that the components of the phase velocities in three directions, Vpx, Vpy and Vpz, are always greater than the velocity vector V0. So this is not a simple vector resolution of the velocity vector of the wave. In fact, the phase velocities are, you have to calculate from the distance traveled by the constant phase point along the z-axis, and that gives you this velocity, which is the intrinsic velocity divided by the direction cosines. So as the wave becomes more and more perpendicular to the z-axis, that means moving in x direction, that means parallel to x-axis, perpendicular to z-direction, the phase fronts now will become parallel to z-axis. And this point, by small tilt, you will see that this point will be moving very rapidly. Even by a small movement of this, the point would have moved by a very large distance along z direction. Whereas the point has moved very little in the x direction when this phase front is almost parallel to the z axis. So what we find from here is that if the wave was moving along the x direction, if the phase fronts were parallel to z axis, then by small movement of the wave, the point moves by a very large distance. And if the wave was parallel, perfectly parallel to z axis, the point essentially moves from minus infinity to infinity, even for an infinitesimal movement of the phase front in the x direction. So when the phase velocity approaches infinity, that time now the phase fronts are moving in the x direction, that means the wave is moving in x direction. So the pointing vector for this wave is in the x direction. There is no power which is moving in z direction now. The power is moving in x direction. So when the phase velocity approaches infinity, we can ask with what velocity the energy is moving in the z direction. So in general, we can ask a question, if the wave is moving with a phase velocity, which is some Vpz in this direction, with what velocity the energy will be moving in this direction, or what is the velocity of the power flow in the z direction? And that we can say very easily that now the velocity which is in this direction, if I take this velocity which is V0, then the velocity in this direction will be V0 multiplied by the cosine of phi z. So the velocity with which this point A will be moving in z direction, that will be V0 multiplied by cos phi z. It will be moving in x direction, will be V0 multiplied by cos phi x. So this velocity with which actually the a given point on the phase front moves in the z direction is what is called the group velocity. That is the velocity with which a particular point on the phase front moves, or that is the velocity with which the energy or the power will move in the z direction. So from here, the velocity of this point, movement in this direction, will be what is called the group velocity. And that is denoted by Vg. And since we are talking about group velocity in z direction, we can put suffix z, that is equal to the intrinsic velocity V0 multiplied by cosine of phi z. So since cosine of phi z is always less than 1, the group velocity, which is the velocity of the energy packet or a particular point on the phase front, that is always less than or equal to the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. So in fact, the group velocity is a resolution of the velocity vector in three direction. The phase velocity is not the resolution of the velocity vector in the three directions. So by this token, if the wave was moving in some arbitrary direction, we essentially can write down the group velocities in the three directions, the similar lines. So we have group velocity in the x direction, which is vg x, that is v0 cos of phi x, vgy, that is v0 cos of phi y, and for sake of completeness, let me write z again. This is v0 cos of phi z. So the group velocities, these three quantities, are bound between 0 and v0, because this quantity, if the angle is 90 degrees, this quantity will become 0. So these three here, vgx or vgy or vgz, that lies between 0 and v0. So now we are having a very interesting situation. For the phase velocity, we have bound which is infinity and v0. So the phase velocity never comes below v0, and the group velocity never goes above v0. So in fact, the domains for the group velocity and the phase velocity are quite exclusive. So we have some kind of a dividing line. This is the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium v0. On this side, you have the phase velocity. Vp, and this side you have a group velocity. Vg. Phase velocity always lies from V0 to infinity, and this will lie from V0 up to 0. Only in a situation when the wave is traveling in the direction either x, y or z, or if I find the velocity of the wave, phase velocity and group velocity, in the direction of the wave motion, then both the quantities Vp and Vg will be equal, and they will be equal to V0. Otherwise, what we see from here, since the group velocity is V0 into phi x and the phase velocity is Vpx is equal to V0 upon phi x, the product of the group velocity and phase velocity is equal to V square. So you take any direction you like, and we have a very important thing, that is Vp multiplied by Vg, that is equal to V0 square. So you take the phase velocity in any arbitrary direction, you take the group velocity in the same direction, and the product of these two quantities is always equal to the square of the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. What that now means is that when the phase velocity approaches infinity, the product of these two is constant, which is V0 square. So this quantity Vg must approach to 0, so that the product is still a finite quantity. So if we want energy flow in the medium, that means the group velocity should not be 0, the phase velocity should not be infinity. So as the phase velocity becomes higher and higher, the velocity of the energy in that direction becomes smaller and smaller. When we see in the direction of the wave motion, both the velocities will become equal. So Vg, Vp, if it travels with the phase velocity equal to V0, Vg will also become equal to V0. And then essentially the phenomena is that the phase, the energy, they all are moving in the same direction with the same speed in the direction of the wave motion. So we have now the important conclusion that whenever we talk about the energy flow or the velocity of the energy in a medium, we have to find out this quantity, what is called the group velocity. However, when we simply talk about the movement of the phase in the medium, then the velocity is given by what is called the phase velocity, and which is always greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. Once we know this phase velocity, then the phase velocity divided by the frequency, that gives you a parameter, what is called the wavelength. So from here, we can get the wavelength of the wave, which is now will be different in different direction, because in x direction the velocity is different. So I can take lambda in x direction, let us say that is equal to the Vpx divided by the frequency f. So here I write down this is V0 upon cos of phi x divided by frequency, and V0 by frequency is nothing but the wavelength in that medium. Let us call that quantity as lambda 0 divided by cos of phi x. Same thing we can have for the other directions also. So what that means is the wavelength which we measure in some arbitrary direction will be always longer than the intrinsic wavelength of the wave. So if I measure the wavelength in the direction of the wave motion, that is lambda 0. But if I measure the wavelength in some arbitrary direction, that wavelength will be always greater than the intrinsic wavelength of the wave. So in this lecture, we saw some important things about a wave which is traveling in some arbitrary direction. That is, the velocities, the phase velocity is always greater than the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. We introduce a new velocity, what is called group velocity, with which the energy travels, and that velocity is always less than the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium, and the product of the group and phase velocity is always equal to the square of the intrinsic velocity of the wave in that medium. And then we also find the wavelength in that medium, which is always longer compared to the intrinsic wavelength of the wave in that medium. So using this concept now, now we can go to the propagation of wave in a semi-infinite medium, where we can now orient the coordinate system which will suit the boundaries, and the wave will be traveling in some arbitrary directions.